diving. He can give you a raffle ticket, and then we're trying to draw it at 3 o'clock. So I hope you can stick around for that. Yeah. Okay, let's move on to Paul. So Paul, I asked Paul, he actually presented last year up in Proserpine at a field day with Dr. Christine Jones, and I thought he'd done such a wonderful job, you know, demonstrating really well how what the tools of regenerative farming are and how you can implement them in a cane system. And today he's going to give us an insight again about some of the tools of regenerative ag in cane and in grazing, just to provide us a bit more of a local perspective. So please put your hands together for Paul.
Thanks for the introduction, Julia, and thank you for the invite to be here today. Probably instead of me rabbiting on about where I'm from and what I do, I've got a little video that I thought I'd just show to cut down on some of that. So we might just crank that up and we'll get into it after that. That should probably tell you a little bit about us. We farm in Proserpine, just on the, if you're going north, just after that last creek on the Lethiebrook Creek. We farm on the right-hand side there between the last creek and sort of the Proserpine River. It's all the big floodplain. So we go sugarcane and run some fattening cow operation there. So yeah, I guess I'm your token farmer for the day, and obviously my speech is not going to be as polished as Graeme's. I think you all agree that was one hell of a talk, Graeme. Excellent work, and we're going to have more of that over the next couple of days. Excellent. So I picked that song, Living on the Edge, for a reason. I really think we as farmers are on the edge at the moment. I think we can go two ways. We can keep going doing what we're doing, or we can jump over the cliff a bit and get into this regen ag. I think globally it's becoming a big it's a big shift. I think we jumped into it a few years back and we're really enjoying the journey. The best thing I like about it is a ground driven. It's from the ground up rather than the top down sort of approach. We don't have too many governments telling us we've got to do this at the moment. It's grower driven, which I think is a bit refreshing. So it's a great time to be learning regenerative ag. And I think ultimately we're all looking for a bit of recognition and probably remuneration more than anything about if we can start to grow probably better quality food. And I think that's what this is all about for human and, as Graeme says, planetary health. I think it's vitally important we get into it. So my background, for those that don't know me, I probably spent more than 25 years in a traditional rural supplies business. Owner, manager, agronomist type roles, salesman roles. About 6 months ago, I decided to jump out of it and really focus on my passion, and that's sort of full-time farming. And with a regenerative slant is where we're at. So I guess for me it all began about 5 years ago. A grazier from Bowen come to Proserpine and he bought some grazing land there, and then he started to dabble into some cane farms. So I was doing his work, agronomy work and some contracting application type work, and one thing led to another, end up sort of managing his farm for him. So the guy's name is Rodney Barrett, and his family, they've been farming or grazing up there at Salisbury Plains just north of Abbott Point for the last 70 odd years, and they take a really regenerative sort of approach and a land-based approach to their business. They got, you know, like 1,200 breeders or something up there, and they do a really good job at sustainability. So when they come to buy cane farms, the same approach was always going to apply. They want to leave the land in better condition than what they take it up in. So for me, coming from an NPK type background and a scorched earth policy of killing everything, was a really different approach, and I really enjoyed the change in the approach to a regenerative system. It's given me, you know, more life in agriculture, I think, because before that I was getting a little bit jack of it. It was just all the same. So I suppose 4 or 5 years ago, not even that, probably 4 years ago, Rodney and I went and did a biofertilizer training course up in the Burdekin. And so we come home madly keen on how we could save some money and in the farming operation and brew some of this stuff up. So we first kicked into the rumen brewing process, the chelating trace elements in the rumen biology, to use mainly as a foliar spray on our sugarcane. So we're just trying to find these little bits that we could do to reduce our chemical input, basically. So we went from there to making the Johnson Sue compost extract, the worm casting extracts, making humic acid out of brown coal and potassium hydroxide, which I don't really recommend anyone should do. It's a bit messy, and it's a pretty shit-house product when you finish with it, to be honest. So we dabbled in a lot of different sort of biological stimulants, biofertilizers, and we still are. So the more we read and watch and podcasts and webinars and that, we gain something out of that. I think it's about keeping an open mind and really sort of just picking up the skills. Today I'm just going to talk a little bit about, it's just over 12 months ago, I went to America and I went and done one of those Soil Health Academy workshops from Understanding Ag. And that's where I sort of met some pretty quirky guys, and most of you would have seen some of their work, Gabe Brown, Ray Archuleta, and another guy, Dr. Alan Williams, amongst some others. And their seminars like a 3 or 4 day thing. I highly recommend if anyone gets the chance, go and do it. It really opens some light bulb moments up for me. I'll tell a funny one to start with. As you do in these seminars, you get there and you put your hand up and you say, oh, hi, I'm such and such from such and such, and this is what I do. So it gets around to me, and Ray Archuleta was hosting the session, and he says, oh, go around the room. Gets to me, and I said, oh, yeah, I'm Paul Rogers. I sell fertiliser and chemicals, and I do a bit of farm management, and I'm from Proserpine in North Queensland, Australia. And Ray's there, he's got a cheeky grin on his face, and he just, ah, Paul, you're the first crack dealer I ever met from Australia. Yeah, right. Everyone starts laughing, and Ray's there, well, you know, you're the man that sells all the bad chemicals and fertilisers to farmers. You're a crack dealer. So that set the tone for the week. I really got on well with Ray after that. He broke the barriers. Move it up and down, or you do up and down on there, Julian? So one of the things I learned over there, and just it just sunk in straight away when I seen it, everything we do in agriculture has an effect. You know, we all know that. But it has an effect, every single practice affects the ecosystem. Like it either makes the ecosystem spiral up or spiral down. And so what was the story with movement? That way. Okay, cool. So everything we do has a compounding and cascading effect. So it compounds, one thing builds on another, and it just gets faster and faster. So depending on what those practices we're doing, it can either be positive or it can be negative. So the soil can either be becoming healthier or it can be becoming unhealthier, in basic terms. And I believe as farmers and graziers that we make decisions daily, and sometimes it's just pure ignorance. We don't know what we don't know. And some of these things we do are completely negative to the soil biology, soil health. And not only that, it's outside the farm, and that flows on to the whole ecosystem, and that's why we've got groups like Reef Catchments, I suppose, trying to pull us up a bit and guide us. But the best thing is all these things are learnable. You know, it doesn't take too much of reading and listening to get better at these things. I'll give you an example. I won't mention names, but I've got a farmer down the road from me. And I watched him over the course of the fallow, you know, from cane coming out to planting again in that 6-month period. He rotary hoed that paddock about 8 times. And I was away for a month. I didn't see 1 or 2 passes, but there was definitely 8. Now, but it happens a lot. And initially, I think he thought, well, I'm going to get rid of this cane crop. And he did what he wanted to do. He wanted to chew it up. And then I think later on, it must have been for weeds. He just wanted to chew it up. Maybe he's gone off glyphosate altogether. But I don't know what's worse. And then later on, before he wanted to plant, well, he probably had a few lumps maybe left in there, and he wanted to chew them up. That was what he wanted to do, and he did it. But I don't think he understood the whole ecological, you know, spiral down that practice sort of created. Hence, he wanted to plant in end of April. He's hoeing again just to get before he planted, and it bucketed down rain. We got 75 mils. That water was still laying on that paddock for 48 hours. He farms on the sand. So it just totally destroyed any structure he had. It doesn't hold any moisture. It doesn't penetrate. So these are all the ecological sort of services that, you know, plants and biology give, that he just destroyed it completely. And it happens a lot. And I guess maybe he just doesn't know, or he chooses to ignore. I'm not sure. I think that's the challenge. So if that's an example of a spiralling down system, when I was in the States, after that great introduction, Ray and Gabe Brown were having a beer and a steak one night, and they said, well, tell us more about the sugarcane. And I said, do you know anything about sugarcane? They said, oh, Ray said he'd sort of seen it a bit in Louisiana, and he appreciated it was a difficult crop because of its, you know, age, it's a monoculture as we do it. And I was sort of asking him questions. How could he help me? We've been dabbling in different sort of tools, but we don't have a system really that spirals up. I won't claim that we've got a system yet, but that's our goal, is to build a system that spirals up. Anyway, Ray said, Paul, you've been here for 2 days. Like, what aren't you getting? I said, oh, well, I want the easy answer. I don't want to have to work it out myself. So he said, go back to the principles we went through today in the workshop. Now, let's just sit here, he said, and let's compare these principles, 6 principles of regen ag, and that's their principles. There's plenty of others, and other groups have got different ones, but they're all very similar. He said, let's compare your current cane farming system to these 6 principles. So we went through it. It took a while. Diversity, you know, how much diversity you got in the sugarcane industry? I know, it's a monoculture for at least 5 years, and even in our fallow, generally speaking, it's either a bare fallow or it's a soybean crop, maybe, in some cases, another monoculture. So he said, you don't win there. You've got a chance to change that. He said, the second one, living, you know, have you got a living root in the ground at all times? So, oh, well, sort of, you know, 5 years, we've got a crop there, but we plant, you know, like a 400-metre wide row on 1.8 metres, so it's probably only 25% or less of the actual soil is covered in a root system. What about your fallow? Oh, yeah, no, some of us do put some stuff in, some just have a scorched earth policy. So he said, you don't rate there either then. That sounds like you've got a lot to work on. So we got around the third point, cover on the soil at all times.
And he said, you guys do a lot of green trash blanketing.
He knew about that.
I think the industry's roughly been doing that for over 30 years. He said, that's really good. You know, that's fix your fallow up, keep cover on that, and you've got that one ticked. You know, you guys are doing pretty well there. A lot of places around the world still burn it. He said, limit disturbance, and we got around to that, and we talked about the different types of disturbance. You know, there's physical, chemical, and there's biological disturbance. Well, purely our mate down the road, he's got the physical one really teed up. He disturbs everything. And chemical disturbance, yeah, a lot of us still use a hell of a lot of chemical, whether it be fertilizers or pesticides. And even now, biological stuff. I mean, there's a fair percentage in this district use, you know, nitrification inhibitors. Whether they're good or bad, yeah, keeping the ammonium forms good, but we're still tinkering with, you know, the nitrous ammonis bacteria. So we're having an effect on biological activity in some way. Animal integration, well, how do we go there? We don't have too many cows running around cane paddocks these days. It doesn't have to be just cows.
It could be any animal, be a chook or a pig or anything. So we you know, as industry, that's poor.
We're talking about context, and by that, Ray was sort of talking about, you know, what's your climate like? Is it suited to the crop? Oh, yeah, we got high rainfall, we got warm temperatures. You know, we don't have massive frost. Sometimes we can get a little one. He said, yeah, well, it sounds like you're growing sugarcane in the right place. It's so you can tick that. He said, you can have that. So we sort of scored 2 out of 6 as an industry. And I don't take it away from anyone here, because a lot of people in this room probably are doing different practices. Don't get me wrong. I'm talking general terms of the sugar industry that I'm well and truly in. Gotta find my notes. I've forgotten where I was. I suppose that chat with Ray, and it really sunk in from my previous time, you know, back in the early 90s when growers were putting in new cane land. You know, they'd go in, they'd plough up the old cow block out the back, that sugar prices were up, let's chuck it in. How many times we all heard the comment, oh, geez, I wish I knew what was in this new ground, because it just grows so much better than the old stuff. You hear it 1,000 times. And it made me sort of think back. You know, I thought it was, is it calcium? Is it some trace element, some magic nutrient? I think there's the answer right there. That native pasture, or even improved pasture, it's got diversity. It's got legumes. It's got weeds. It's got grasses. It's got trees. It's pretty good. Living root in the ground at all times. Yeah, absolutely. It ticks the box. Cover on the soil, mostly. We can probably get that better at times. Disturbance, don't see anyone going in and ploughing up a cow paddock just for the hell of it. Bugger all chemical goes on, no one fertilises too much of the pastures in this district. No biological issues. We've got animals, and the context is great. So it's no wonder that system fails, or decreases, I should say, and we're getting some hangover into that first 5-10 years of the cane crop, because we've done those things for hundreds and thousands of years, probably. So there's a hangover, there's a lag effect into the cane. It grows really well. 5-10 years later, all those things get burnt up and we start spiralling downwards. It's a pretty, you know, that's in its simplest form. That's probably a system. I wouldn't say it's spiralling up at a hell of a rate, but it is better than what we take it into when we go back to cane. So, I guess that leads to where, you know, we as a company, and I just manage the place, I don't own it. We have a very good relationship where we just work at this all the time. It can be 2 o'clock in the morning and Rodney will be sending through an email from some study he's found, and he's on it all the time, and it creates a pretty good environment. So we're unashamedly in farming to make money, but at the same time to regenerate the soil and leave it to the next generation. We see that reduced cost of inputs is probably the biggest single thing we can do to try and improve our bottom line. We don't dictate the price of sugar. We are price takers. So if we can reduce our inputs by using other products, stimulants, biology, and just using that system of with nature rather than against it, we think we can do okay at it, and so far we think we are. So in the last 4 years, yep, we've done multi-species cover crops. We've put cows on it. We've intercropped the cane with radishes and mung beans and things. All our extracts, whether it be worm or whether it be compost extract or whether it be biofert brews, we've really gone and focused this last sort of 6 months on limiting our disturbance of physical. So we want to go from a just harvested cane crop through a fallow with two passes, if we can. The third one being the planter. We'll see how that goes in the next couple of months, but that's sort of our aim. That's with a cover crop on that as well. So we're a fair way from just conventional meat and three veg type farming in cane. We're trying to have a crack at some different stuff, and that's been challenging at times. But I think our whole aim has been to try all these different, get all these skills under our belt. Each one of them takes a bit of learning. Don't think you can go from here to where you want to get in 1 or 2 years. You're going to have to learn all those skills to build it into a system is my thoughts on it. And without doubt, there's been some hard lessons. And I think it's just as important to share the hard lessons or the failures, if you like, as it is the successes. I think if there's any complaint that I have in my head, well, not complaint, but just thought in my head, what we see, I don't think we tend to share our failures, because they're just as important, if not more important, than our wins. And I think the industry, we need to get better at that, share our failures and just let other people learn where you went. So I'm going to share one now. I'm just going to have a drink. So We have been fairly buoyed by our sort of early success, and we haven't lost yield, which to us was important. For us to have that better bottom line, we've got to keep our yields up, but reduce our costs. I think it comes up somewhere a bit later. This year is probably a good example. We harvested 250 hectares and we yielded 23,500 tonne off that. So we're in the mid-90 tonnes per hectare, and it's been that way for since I started there 5 years ago, before we started doing these practices. So we're happy with that, but we're vigilant. We don't want to see it drop too much. So our fertiliser use has come back by 40%. So we get the regular soil sample, six easy steps in is the nitrogen methodology. It might say 140, 150. We're averaging 80 kilos per hectare of nitrogen. So just to give you an example of how things went a bit pear-shaped this year, we're pretty buoyed. We had, you know, we read a lot, and the secret was multi-species cover cropping in the fallow, minimum till, compost extract. We had all these tools in our pocket, and we were prepared to use them and put nothing else on, go nude, basically. So we really wanted to make a success of this, and as much as you want, it doesn't always happen. So we even decided to use the old stick planter because we wanted the perfect stick. We didn't want that to be the problem. We didn't want to blame a planting contractor. We wanted to narrow in on it ourselves. So we used no fertilizer, no insecticide, no fungicide. When we planted, we used our Johnson Sue compost extract with homemade humic acid and a bit of molasses, a couple of litres per hectare, all down the tube, on the plants. And if you remember April very well, it was a little bit, it was wet. We had a few stop-start goes at planting in April. But anyway, by the end of April, we got it all done. We met our target. We wanted to be planted by the end of April. We wanted to use no inputs. I've got them on my thing there, but there's some really great photos. Those first couple of weeks, even a month after planting, I'd never seen root structure like it. You know, there was lateral roots coming off all those sort of main shoots, and I've never seen that before like that. So we were pretty cocky, to be honest. And but April kept on raining. If anything, it got a little bit cool a bit quick. One of the things we soon learned is with our system, we hadn't quite nailed it down. The stick planter, we hadn't done much homework on that. We planted a little bit deep, to be honest. It got cold, it got wet. Initially, it was all coming out of the ground, but you know, that initially is nothing. It's at the end of the day, we didn't have a good enough strike, a good enough population. So some of that failed, and out of the 40 hectares we planted in April, we probably had to replant 25. Interesting, the stuff we've let go and left there, you could probably argue maybe we shouldn't have plowed so much out. It's actually not looking too bad now, whether it's responded or it's a little bit interesting. So that was a failure, but we'll learn from that. And we're not giving up on the idea of incidentally, the phosphorus levels in that soil type were fairly high. You know, I didn't think it was a great risk because our phosphorus levels, you know, were like 50 or 60. So it was, anyway, it was a risk too much. And there's one lesson in this regen ag stuff is you've got to earn the right to reduce your inputs. And maybe we just hadn't earned the right enough. So we'll take that on board. So nearly 12 months ago, that's about the cane. Do you want to ask questions about the cane stuff before we move on to the grazing, or do we just leave questions to the end? Yeah. No, actually, I haven't got too many on the cane. There's more in the... That was in that video. I did fail to put those in. So if there's no questions about the cane, if there is, happy to answer them.
Yeah, sorry. My question is around compaction in the cane paddocks, like with the big gear that we use these days, et cetera. How do you get around that? And I'm interested in your thoughts. You would be familiar with the yeoman style implements with the coulter in front. Are they destructive or they can be used carefully?
We'd use contractors. Our whole regenerative theory is use a contractor instead of having stuff laying around the farm as well, rusting. So we've always used conventional contractors, come in, rip the hell out of it, you know, laser it, rip the hell out of it, offset it deep. And we're just sort of, we're going away from that a bit and just going to we don't have a big tractor. Our biggest tractor is 155 horsepower. And we just went and bought one of them bed renovators. So it's got a massive ripper in the front. It's got scallop discs throwing it out. And another set behind it, throwing it back in and forming the mound with a crumble roller to shape the bed in the one pass. And we'll use that to inject biology as well. So regenerative means a lot of things to a lot of people, like and different things too. So, yeah, while it's only one row at a time, that's all we've got to pull it. And that's fine. Others have got, if you want a three row one of them, you need like 350 horsepower. We don't have that. So, yeah, I'm not sure, to be honest. We think we're ripping the old stool out and getting rid of compaction there, but...
I think Deb might want to answer your question, so I didn't know who asked. Yeah, Deb, would you mind just maybe commenting on the Yeoman plow? I know that you use it personally on your farm, including some others. Mandy, where's the mic?
Yeah, no, we use a Yeoman in our pasture country, but we don't have cane, and the cane that we're just taking out on the new farm, we are using the Yeoman on that just to break up that hard pan. But we have ours set at 700 mil, so we still go through the pasture. And, yeah, it's a useful tool. Our country's still very hard, so but I can't give you an answer in cane, but what Paul's talking about is... the concept to allow the minimum passes with one operation with what he's got there. But yeah.
Alan McLean. Yes. Back in school, you're on the spot. Alan is a cane farmer and he is a member of the Central Queensland Soil Health System Group. He's actually the current chair. I'm sure you have a comment regarding compaction in cane and what do you do about it?
Yeah, thanks, Julia. Yeah, Paul, that's interesting. One, we've got quite a few new members have just joined our group, and with regards to the old cane land, have you got any suggestions of where would be your first starting point to go down this track? I'll fill you in a little bit. We've been going down the track for 6 years now of remineralising our soils with some pretty significant benefits, you know, biological, less tillage, all of what Graeme and you have spoke about this morning. But for somebody that wanted that's bought an old cane farm and to regenerate and mainly to get that have gone out of cane and into cattle, where would you start, Paul? Where now that you know what you've learned over the last 4 or 5 years, where would you begin to rejuvenate that soil?
Yeah, I only know what I know. So, to go back into cane?
No,
to go back into pasture. Just do that. Plant a most diverse species of plants and legumes and forbs that you can. Or haven't got to that point.
Graeme and
One of the biggest things about sugar cane is every year there's a massive amount of micronutrients taken away from that paddock, and there's most of the cane ground has been growing cane for 100 years or more, and there's none of those micronutrients left, like the minor elements. It'd be pretty hard to get a plant to grow in that sort of a situation. And would you, where would you start? I'd like to get your two bobs worth on, Paul.
Oh, I think no expert, but I think in this whole system, it's the plants and the biology that solubilize the inherent minerals that are there. There's a ton of minerals and nutrients in that soil already. We just can't get at them. Sugarcane sucked them out as best we can, and it's compacted and done all those things that make it hard to get at. You've got to create that fungal environment, I think. Big pore spaces in your soils. The plants will do that.
think we've got to give it time, but fast tracking it, probably talk to Graeme. He's probably got some pretty cool products there that could fast track that. But
I was going to say, because I inherited a similar situation with my large new apple farm and 43 years of chemicals, and I'm talking chemicals, apples, on the dirty dozen list, which is 192 chemicals measured in 212 crops, apples number one for 17 years straight. So, you know, if you do nothing, eat organic apples rather than the poison ones. And that's the systemic insecticides used to control codlin moth and, of course, fruit fly. So I inherited lots of chemicals, and the biological counts were low. The chemical residues were still present to some degree. The only one that's really hard to pull out is deodorant. The trick is to clean it up before you start. And in that instance, it's high-dose fulvic acid, 3 kilos per hectare. And we did that twice. And we did counts, microbial counts, and, of course, chemical counts before and after. And for all intents and purposes, we cleaned it up. So we can't actually measure much of them. So you can actually fix stuff quite quickly. And that's the starting point. You've got the biology back, and then you start pouring in the biology. I've got this thing called Nutrition Central, a 40-foot container. There's 9 minerals that are lacking on soil and leaf tests. We've got 9 drums, 1,000 all inside this 40-foot container, 1,000 litres of humic, 1,000 litres of fulvic, 1,000 litres of kelp, a mixing tank and a fertigation tank, the whole length of the 40-foot, all got smart valves on them, tied into a controller and computers. And then outside, also with smart valves, are all the brewing tanks. Nothing goes out without micros behind it. You put the micros behind the minerals. They fuse together in the mixing tank, pump through from the outside to the inside, and you just fire up that soil. We're growing the entire crop with no basal fertilizer. It's all just fertigation and foliar. And you've got to look at, well, I'm not going to get cocky because we already had our neighbor knocked out with a late frost and there's been 2 hailstorms, and that can happen at any time. But, and so it's a bigger gamble than a TAB gambler, of course, as you all know with farming. But the starting point is that you clean it up and then you bring in humic acid, feeds the fungi. The fungal counts on that soil were pathetic. We just brew your own, put out 20, 30 liters a hectare. That's $6 a hectare. Is not expensive. You just, well, in this case, it's a little harder, but we've got fertigation. We just pump it through there, and the fungi's back. And the fungal count's really quite good now. So you can do it quite quickly. You can regenerate quite rapidly if you just know the strategies. Sorry, I won't. You're doing a great job.
Good on you, Graeme. Thanks for the tips there.
Just one more question.
Yeah, mate.
Yeah, in the sugarcane industry where I'm in there too, it's not so much the... In our fallow. For us in the sugar industry, it's not so much in our fallows and first returns, because and plant angle, we can do all that. The biggest problem with the sugar thing is our returns. They go for 5, we can go up to 10, 15 years with that same crop all the way through. And to me, what I reckon, basically on my own opinion, is it's compaction. Compaction, our biggest killer. Every time we harvest a crop, every row gets run over 4 times by machinery that's 25 ton plus all the time. So compaction's used. And as you said, if you want to get your biology to work, the biggest limiting factor is oxygen. We've got to get the oxygen going. And the second thing is a food source. We've got a living plant there, but if we're putting synthetic fertilisers on, the plant's not pumping exudates, might only be 15, 20%. If we can get the plant to photosynthesise up to 40, 50%, and that's the food source for our biology, that's the biggest problem. Our biology is not surviving how we're farming. So I'm using the ripper to get it in there, to aerate the ground, to get oxygen into the soil. But don't forget, air is 78% nitrogen, and nitrogen's our biggest thing we want to get into the ground. And then if we can get the biology working, so we're doing extracts, same as what probably Paul's doing here too. It's the next succession of protozoans and nematodes that eat the bacteria and fungi that releases the nitrogen and releases all our minerals, the photosynthesis. While we're using a lot of the synthetic fertilizers, all our secondary predators, the protozoans, the nematodes, arthropods and all them there, they're not there. So basically we're trying to re-inoculate the ground again, give them a food source, a living plant. This is Christine Jones, where she says the fastest way to build carbon is with a living plant. But if it's not photosynthesized than what it should, we're not putting the exudates in there and we're not building carbon. For the sugar industry, we're growing a crop and we've got 10, 15 tons of residues. We should be blowing heaps of carbon, but we're not. It's just oxidizing on top of the ground and we're not utilizing it.
Thanks, John. You're amazing.
Cool. Thanks, John. We'll move on to the cattle business. I've only been playing with these cattle for about 12 months. They're next door. There's 1,100 hectares. We run about 800 head of these, mostly these Brangus cattle. They're going to live export or to feedlots. So, new industry for me. All I knew about cattle was they taste all right with some mushroom gravy and a few veggies. So when I come into this, I knew I had to start put my head down and start learning a bit. I'd had some training, listen to the Dr. Alan Williams. Everyone gets a chance to listen to him. Google him, YouTube him, if you're into pastures. He's an American cattle geneticist and has an amazing head on him for all things cattle. He's an amazing bloke. I'll tell you a story about him quickly. He was giving this lecture last year in America, and he's telling us about his own business. He's an educator, and he, before that, was a scientist, but he also has his own grazing business with cattle, sheep, goats, you name it. That he has a line of beef that he markets to the market, either direct market or supermarkets or straight to restaurants, and he claims that that line of beef has more omega-3 fatty acids in it than wild-caught salmon. And that's how he markets it, and that's how he gets a hell of a premium for it. So he will feed those animals on canola and sunflowers and just in the mix, in the mixed species. He also sells a line of lamb. It's rosemary infused. He plants rosemary in the paddock. True story. So, but that's just a way for him that he extracts more out of his lamb. Julia asked me today to explain some of the tools we use. I'm new at it, so I need tools. It doesn't come naturally. So, 10 minutes. I get my knowledge from all sorts of guys. Graeme's one of them. I listen to his podcasts and I absorb it all and I go away and do it. So, observation's the biggest tool you got. These other tools I've started to use, measuring bricks, feed budgets are essential, NIRS, fecal analysis for nutrition, supplement the trough water with urea, phosphorus, and when needed, and some trace elements, and also time control grazing and using density to your advantage. So I'll just run through some of these, how they work, if anyone... So, bricks... Yep, I got a $70 refractometer. We use it in the sugar industry to see how much sugar we got, which paddock we want to harvest first. So dug that out, and so I was dumped in this position where there's a paddock, there's 800 head in it. I get out there and I'm observing what's going on. I mentioned before in the slide that we have pangola and paragrass and some hibernacne in the swamp. So it's about 50-50 between the pangola and the paragrass and hibernacne. Put a cattle into a new paddock, they just go straight for the paragrass. They sit on that, chew the hell out of it, and they'll do everything they can not to go to the pangola. I was told that pangola was, you know, one of the best tropical grasses we got. So I had that in the back of my head. I watched and learnt. The cattle go into the paragrass. They shit through the eye of a needle. It's very high in protein. It's very good tucker. As soon as they go onto the pangola or have to go onto the pangola, their dung's stacking up straight away, you know, within a few days, and their performance starts going backwards. Couch grass, 1%. Wouldn't recommend you eat that. Coloured roads was there at 4. I observed the cattle going into a new paddock, so we were doing some sort of rotational grazing. Straight in, hit the weeds. Not what I would have expected, 9% bricks, but hey, I don't know much about it. Blackberry, cobbler's peg, whatever it was, they were into that. And they loved it. Unfortunately, there wasn't that much of it. So, and some of my learnings, I think on the next... that's the projector. So I gathered some data, which I'll have here in a minute. This came out of the States. I'll get it. So I'll just go back a bit more. So plant bricks, why does it matter? I think we heard earlier how the bricks in the plant, which is basically the soluble sugars and proteins in the plant, the good stuff, it rises during the day. After lunch, 2-3 o'clock, it's at its peak. So when you're doing any of this stuff, you've got to make sure you do it at the same time every day to get any comparisons. So we're talking live weight gain, average daily gain. If you want, you know, up around that kilo per animal per day, you've got to have your bricks up around 8 to 12. If you want higher, you've got to have it higher. This slide here shows that the dry matter required. This is a bit of a... I think the way this was done was a little bit... So there's a bit of a model in here. If you've got forage bricks down the side, the percentage of live weight, we know, you know, it's general rule of thumb is about 3% live weight of their live weight. That's how much dry matter you've got to eat a day. So the higher the bricks, the less you have to eat for a given weight gain. That's probably the caveat there, for a given weight gain. So bricks is good. Bricks is, we can eat less and we do better. Sounds good? I won't get into the other side of it where pests don't like high bricks plants. We'll leave that. Feed budgets. Yeah, I've learned a couple of different ways of feed budgeting, and I'll tell a story that when I took this project on, there was another person was managing the pastures, and I think there's a gross underestimation of the feed in the paddock. So they were going to the paragrass in the swamps. I'd eat that out for a few days. I'd get the message, oh, you're only allowed to have them cattle in there for 10 days. You've got to go to the next paddock. So I'd move them. They'd say, what's it look like? I said, oh, well, you know, I've eaten all the paragrass. And they probably haven't touched the pangola too much. Oh, I'll just get rid of them, move them out. So all they're doing was the pangola was getting ranker and ranker to the point that's actually quite short. It's only 30 centimetres deep there. So I'd learnt a system through RCS of like a stock days per hectare. You'd look at it and you'd make an assessment. Go, oh, yeah, there's 100 stock days per hectare. I only want to take 50%. So, you know, you put 100 animals in there and feed's gone, bang, away you go. I learned this one in the States, which really suits my situation. It won't suit everyone's, where it's really dense grass. I just use that stick, measure it. That there says it's about 30 centimetres high. So there's 3,000 kilos of dry matter in that paddock. You do have to lay it down then and do another assessment of how many marks you can see. If you can see 100%, well, then that reading is correct. If you can only see 50% of those marks through the grass, it's only 50% of that. So feed budgeting, pretty easy. It's just maths. Divide what you got or what you want to actually use by the number of cattle you got. Work out your cell size. So I change the cell size pretty much on the run, depending on the area of the paddock that I got to play with that day. So it can be anywhere from, you know, 2 hectares to 4 hectares. With 800 head just moving. But we've been sitting on a stock and density of like 200 LSUs per hectare. People think it's mad. I've seen recently guys doing 1,000 per hectare, but they'll shift them. To do that, they'll have to shift them every 4 or 5 hours, which don't always have that sort of time. I've just come back from a course in Townsville at RCS, Grazing for Profit course, and talked to a guy from Catherine. Yeah, he was using, he used a different system. He used kilograms per hectare of animals. Yeah, up to 1 million, but they were doing it as an experiment. Did it for 10 minutes at a time. But he reckons the priming of that land, it just the improvement over in doing that a couple of times on that land, just primed it for so much better production, going on 3 or 4 years. So you don't have to do it all the time. I think it's just a tool that we use to improve ground or address whatever resource concern, as Gabe Brown would say. That you've got. The next one, we'll just race through a couple of minutes. Oop. Yeah, we've done that. That's pretty quick. Just basic stuff. Top one, if you know, this is from the start, over 15 days. If you take too much grass and you're grazing, it's going to take a long time for that root system to develop. The root system falls off and basically it takes weeks and months and even years to recover from a really hard grazing. If you just take 20, 30, 40%, whatever you're trying to do, that root system will come back 15 days later. As long as there's moisture there, you're back on it. There's a good example, some numbers. If you take down to only 40% of your forage, you won't have any root system stoppage. The minute you go past 50%, you know, if you take 90% of the plant material above the ground, you'll have no roots growing there. Well, you'll have no roots left. They basically just appear. They've got to regenerate. So in a grazing management thing, as a soil, I suppose this is what we're here for, sorry, soil health situation, if you've got roots, you're photosynthesizing, you're pumping the sugars into the ground, the biology's there to do its job, and the forage is going to be much better because it's going to solubilize minerals and make that plant grow. And the bricks is going to be a hell of a lot higher. So it sort of all falls into one. You just got to get it the system right. Yeah, this is some interesting stuff. Always wondered how much the manure is worth. So someone sat down and done a study. If you continuously graze a paddock, put all your cows in that paddock and leave them there permanently, it'll take 27 years to get one pump of manure on every, this is in square yards, not metres, but same diff. Take 27 years to get around and get a blob on every one. If you shift cattle every day at the right stocking rate to carrying capacity, it takes one day. What's that worth? This is the whole cycle. This is how we keep things moving and moving and improving. There's another one. This is an example of there's a trough in that bottom corner on both paddocks. Top paddocks, is the top area is cut into three. The bottom one's cut into 24. So that more even manure distribution is, well, it's very visual, isn't it? You're grazing the same area, you're just cutting it up, getting it more dense. Hell of a lot more manure. What's that worth? Always come back to the dollars. That's what's in manure. If you went over that paddock three times in a year, that's the nutrient you would get out of manure. I haven't forgotten my numbers from Fertiliser World. That's about $245 a hectare value on every hectare. So we don't need fertiliser. I don't know too many around here that would put on that sort of rates of fertiliser. There's just some, no doubt, on their pasture. Most get nothing. So rotational grazing, density, you do get a return. Sorry, yep. Next to nothing, not that much. There is some phosphorus in the bones, no doubt about it, and you always got to take that into account. But the cycling rate, the new phosphorus coming from the soil, from the biology, is making more. Handy tool, I don't know if too many people know about that one, just to prove up the thought of where the diet's going when it changes feed. We do these NIRS tests quite regularly now, about every month, and it gives you readings of protein in the manure, which is basically same as what the cow's getting. So you can tell if your protein's down, you can start feeding a supplement of some sort. The digestibility is probably the biggest one. As that feed's getting old, how much it can digest, so how much nutrient it gets out of the grass, and it's quite stark. The difference between like a 55 and a 60 is quite amazing. I think they cost about $60. Yeah, a 2-week turnaround. Handy tool. Our protein was down, and especially in those Pangola paddocks, so we implemented some direct injection technology where they just pump it into your water supply. We're very lucky. We've got one water supply in the whole place. Injecting in, I think at the moment, it's roughly working at about 40 grams of urea a day, a small amount of phosphorus, and some trace elements. Works out at 7.5 cents per head per day. Current beef market, that's not too bad. Doesn't do it justice, but there was a paddock I crashed with 200 LSUs and for 1 hectare one day. On the left-hand side, it wasn't grazed at all. That's about, that white line is my hot wire. And you can see where I slashed it to get that hot wire in there. There is a bit of activity, a bit of green on that side. Just the animal impact on this side a month later with no rain. It's almost the same grass. It's hard to tell in that photo. I don't expect you to believe me, but it's a hell of a lot greener. No rain. And the density of the grass, it's pretty much the same within a month from where it wasn't grazed.
I think that's it.
Producers that have any questions or any more cane questions or comments? No? Yes, we've got Deb.
That's great, Paul. I was just wondering about the bricks data that you put up earlier on, and was that your data in terms of bricks reading and how it equates to daily gain?
No, the first numbers of mine in the paddock were mine. The rest was something I extrapolated out of the soil health guys in the States.
Yep.
Yeah.
Are you weighing, so you'll be able to firm that up with what you're doing?
Yeah, and just on that, I was doing my grazing for profit course this week, and I was talking to David McLean, and I showed him those numbers, and he was very interested. He said, I haven't seen these. Where the hell did you get them? He wants them. Mm. So, yeah, it's a bit unknown. That's why I put it up there, yeah.
Yep. Yeah, great, thank you.
Who do I pick? Graeme, do you want to make a comment? Yeah?
Relative to a simple explanation for those that still don't subscribe or recognise the value of cell grazing, if we're going to accept that science, the definition is adherence to natural laws and principles that we're learning from nature, then one question we may ask is, what was the most productive area in the history of mankind? And if we ask that question and look at the science, we find that by far it's the Great Plains in the US, followed very closely by the Nile Valley until we dammed it all and stopped the big wash of topsoil that came down every year. And how did the Great Plains produce more biomass every year for tens of thousands a year than any other square metre on the planet until we stepped in and wrecked it in about six decades and created the Dust Bowl? That was about livestock, and it was about bison or buffalo with a predator effect, wolves or whatever on the side. So you're there, your head's next to someone else, you're not choosy about what you eat, you're depositing massive amounts of dung and urine. And of course we talked about dung, we didn't talk about urine. You have to go to India and see perhaps why they call the cow the sacred cow. There's not a farm that I've visited, and I visited the guy who won Farm of the Year last year while the Prime Minister was there giving him the Indian of the Year award. Everyone uses every drop of cow urine because it's the highest known source, natural source of nitrogen, and we just waste it all. And of course that's part of what you're getting, and there's many other nutrients. I'm just in the middle of a grant that's just gone through. It looks like we're going to win it with a bunch of professors in a multiple society recycling human urine because it's the highest source. It's ridiculous we're not using it. The Chinese, every new apartment block, there's a poo toilet, there's a wee toilet. They compost the poo, they recycle the urine, pull out the chemicals from our drugs and things, and it becomes a nitrogen source for agriculture. So massive amounts of dung and urine, hoof bed, creating a bit of a seed bed, a bit of biodiversity in the poo. But the lesson was, why did those bison in their hundreds of thousands always stop grazing at 4 inches? And it's so simple. This is the whole basis of it. If you dig down, you've got 6 inches with 15 centimetres. We want to go that way. You've got, of the main root structure, 15 centimetres, the solar panel, which is what the leaf is, picking up sunlight, water, CO2, creating glucose, feeding the roots. 6 inches sustains 6 inches. You can dig down, you've got 6 inches below 6 inches. You graze down to 4 inches, the roots prune themselves because 4 inches can't sustain 4 inches, 6 inches below. So they prune themselves to 4. You graze to 2. You graze down to the dirt because your dad said you've got to go down to the dirt boy to get it all. You got nothing. You got no system being fed by the solar panel. And that's what the whole deal is. So simple. It's like, why wouldn't everyone have realized that? And I've traveled to so many thousands of farms, and there are thousands upon thousands of examples of the value of intelligent grazing, which is the small grazing effect. Exactly, that was a great presentation. I really enjoyed it. Anyway, that's just a simple reason of how and why it works.
Thanks, Graeme. Yeah, emphasising the importance of rest again. Any final comments before we move on to lunch? Mandy, has the lunch been put out yet? Yes. Okay, well, let's break for lunch. We've got 40 minutes.